person who has like saved his life who is sitting here. The second issue actually I'd like to express my sincere thanks to my dear brother, great friend, intimate colleague. First of all, thank you for this kind invitation for me to come today. And I'd like to wish you the best of luck, the best of success actually here in this course, which will be highly calibrated one. And today I'm going to speak about a dialysis and pregnancy. From the physician perspective, from the obstetric point of view, in the next 20 minutes, I'm going to look at the magnitude of the drops. This is a common problem. Shall we see a pregnant lady on dialysis commonly or not? This is this point. The next, what are the challenges we meet our everyday practice for those ladies? The set issues, the complications, and finally the obstetric management. Allow me to start by presenting this quote from Shakespeare, that the wealth of our life is the mingle we are, the good and the ill together. Right? And this is an argument in the Rahmat al-Hayah, Tub al-Hayah, or Tub Mazul al-Alam al-Aman. The wealth of our life is the mingle we are, the good and the ill together. And let me say that it was so early, 1971, when the first report of the successful delivery, this lady, 35 years old lady, successful pregnancy and delivery, that patient was on hemodialysis. That's a good reaction. And could you imagine that after only 9 years, in 1980, the percentage has been described by this esteemed register, which is the European Dialysis and the Transplant Association register, that's the main founder here of the course, as I know from my colleague. It has been reported to be one ninth. Could you imagine that we are nearly speaking that one person, speaking in one person, which is the highly related issue. And more recently, in this publication last year, it has been reported to be up to 7%. So the magnitude is rising. Speak now, 7 out of 100 pregnant ladies. And let me say that, as Murijan mentioned in this recent publication, that the majority of the nephrologists encounter 1 or 2 pregnant patients of hemodialysis during their lifetime in practice. So you would face at least 1 lady during your lifetime practice. I think that the magnitude is going to rise, and we have to look with an intuitive eye to this fight. And really we have a challenge. This is a challenge problem. If you ask your wife, this is a chronically ill patient, how she can get pregnant? The healthy one has troubles in getting pregnant. What about the ill patient? The fertility drops in those ladies, of course. Why? They have got anemia. They have got hyperprolactinemia. They have got a disturbance in the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. It means that the ovary is going to stop ovulation because this is a general chronic ill condition. On the second aspect, they are depressed. They lost healthy to their life. And they lost the importance of the sexual life. They are not interested in doing their sexual life properly. So the present will be reduction in the fertility power. And really we are so thankful for the improved efficacy of the dialysis, so thankful for this routine and its introduction for the correction of anemia, for improvement of the general condition of the lost pregnant ladies, and for having and enjoying their sexual life that ended with the increased fertility action. And that's why it gets increased in the last few years. And that is the progress of science. Is there other challenges? Yes, we have other challenges. What are those? first point is the diagnostic challenge. The main issue with the late diagnosis, the symptoms encountered in those ladies are irregular cycles and abdominal pain, and the obstetrician might not make up his mind to say these are chronic patients. It's quite easy to say these symptoms didn't relate to pregnancy, so he didn't make his mind. So this is the late diagnosis. The second point, and this is more and more important, that the, you know, the human period blood between, that is the hormone of pregnancy. You diagnose pregnancy by the fetus of the this hormone. At the end of the day, it's excreted in the kidney. So the kidney is an L kidney. And urine is not produced well, so you cannot diagnose pregnancy easily. You got it. So we have a challenge in the symptoms and the challenge in the main way of diagnosis. And that's why we have to look and to rearrange our minds and to suspect a possible pregnancy. If there is a further deterioration of anemia in those ladies, if there is apparent resistance to erythropoietin, and if there is hypotension episodes of unknown cause, we have to suspect pregnancy. Don't consider it absolute and say it's chronic irritation, it's not a chronic. You have to rearrange your mind, and we should realize that ultrasound is the only reliable method to calculate the gestational age. This is the only reliable method. Okay? Moving to the third point, that the complications. And as any spectrum in our specialty, we look to the mother and the fetus as both partners in the same body. So we are going to expect complication in the mother and complication in the baby. In the mother, we have miscarriage or abortion. That is in less than 40% of cases, according to the recent reports. Importantly, anemia. That's again a major important issue. Polyhydramnios. That is increase the amount of the amniotic fluid around the baby. That might happen due to the osmosis of urea. The baby, up to 70%, we speak now in 3/4 of the patient. You imagine? We speak in 75 out of 100 might have this problem of polyhydramnios, which might end in preterm labor, another catastrophe. Another issue, and this is a big, big major issue, is hypertension. Challenging issue, actually, in those patients, specifically. Pre-eclampsia and eclampsia reported up to 80%. 8 out of 10 patients might have this catastrophic issue, pre-eclampsia and eclampsia. It's not the issue of hypertension. You know that pre-eclampsia and eclampsia? I think you have an idea about it. Hemorrhage and this. That is the maternal complications. About the complications of the baby, we have intracranial growth restriction. That the growth of the baby is below the standard levels. The drama of intracranial fetal death, sudden loss of the baby. After the big dream of having a nice baby, the baby went away. The preterm birth, and finally the neonatal death. So how could we manage those ladies? That's a big, important question. Really, it's a big, important question. We have a serious pathology, patient on dialysis, and she's pregnant. And let me highlight what James Butler says someday, that not everything is that phase can be changed, but importantly, nothing can be changed until it's fixed. That's really, actually, not right. And let me say it again, in our language here, in practical language, that we need a teamwork, a multidisciplinary approach. We need the joint efforts of the nephrologists, the obstetricians, and the nutritionists. The three should work together to get the most successful post ladies. This is a very important, and the first fair message today I'd like to send it to you. Again, remembering you with this dictum, I know that one of my colleagues is going to address this issue, so I'm not going to speak about it. That would be how to adjust the dialysis treatment. He's more experienced than me. Frequency, duration, technique, membrane types, BUN, DIAZ, etc., etc. I'll leave all these issues for him. How to prevent metabolic acidosis. The rule of the erythropoietin, because you are quite experienced rather than the obstetricians in the use of erythropoietin. I'm going to speak just about the control of the blood pressure. And I'm going to leave the calcium phosphorus metabolism. All these issues are going to be covered soon. Also, I don't know if there is an inversion, going to speak with Mats about this point, but I think we have to have a food for a nutritionist about the protein intake and the caloric intake and the supplement of water soluble vitamins that could be dialyzed, and this is just a hit point for this point. Importantly, what I'm going to speak is the obstetric management. And really we focus on the corrective anemia. This is important. Control of the blood pressure. Prevention of preterm births and adequate fetal monitoring. I am interested as an obstetrician in the policy of management of prostatitis to achieve these goals. Regarding anemia, the first and the major point, you should know that 1,400 milligrams of iron is needed throughout the whole pregnancy. Extra iron is needed due to the physiology of pregnancy. So we have to provide iron and folic acid supplements, and we do frequent checks of hemoglobin and ferritin values and to adjust the diabetic protein dosage. And again, I'd like to leave it to my colleague. Those patients are managed in what's called the high pregnancy units. High pregnancy units. And in Europe now, there is another unit, another second level known as HDU, or the high dependency units. These are the units before the ICU. So you can know how important the care is to give him this specialized unit class. And we have to maintain hemoglobin between 10 and 11 grams, and hematocrit between 30 and 35%. This is the issue. Going to the control of the blood pressure, and this is a major challenge. Really a major challenge. Why it's a major challenge? Because you would like to reduce the blood pressure and to ensure maternal safety, that's fine, but at the end of the day, you have to take care so as not to compromise the intraplacental perfusion. If the blood pressure drops, what will happen? The placental separation is going to reduce, the baby is going to die. So this is a very, very crucial issue. How would you play and ensure maternal safety and at the same time not compromising the placental circulation? Another issue, and we need to have a look and to keep an eye, is like any patient in dialysis, the initial treatment is adjusting the volume using ultrafiltration. But in preeclampsia, it's not a volume hypertension. It's a vasoconstriction. So if you apply this issue and you do fluid extraction, you might exacerbate the hypoperfusion of the various organs. So another challenge. So it's not an easy point to manage these ladies and doing this controlled hypertension. But at the end of the day, we have to maintain the diastolic blood pressure between 80 and 90 millimeters. That is the base. Don't consider that drop to 70 is success. No, you are going to impede the intraplacental blood flow and the baby is going to die. The antihypertensive medications, we have the alpha methyl load that we are interested as obstetricians. The alpha methyl load, the beta blockers, the arterial vasodilators, and the calcium channel blocker. And as an obstetrician, I refer you to this famous book. This is the Chelsea Hypertensive Disorders in Pregnancy. The Professor Chelsea died since 2000, and now his students is propagating the book. And this table is speaking about the oral antihypertensive, and an obstetrician, I'm interested for the risk according to the FDA classification. The alpha methyl, this is the famous drug we use. It's grade D. You know the classes of the FDA, I think it's easy for everyone. A, B, C, D, and X, and E. And we have the labetalol, this is grade C. This is nifedipine, calcium channel, grade C. Hydralazine, grade C. Diuretics has a limited rule in managing preeclampsia specifically. And the contraindicated is the ACE inhibitors and the ARB receptor antagonist, they are plus D. So this is for the commonly used medication, the oral agents. And for emergency, again, I'd like to refer you to the same textbook that's famous. This is hydralazine, which could be used, it's grade C. Labetalol, grade C. Nifedipine, grade C. And these are the dosages, I think you are experiencing in those dosages. And I leave again my colleague in the nephrology to speak in details about it. The next point, which is quite important for us, is to prevent the preterm labor. You know, preterm labor is a major issue even abroad. Because if the baby is a preterm labor, you mean that the baby is going to the incubator, you will have all the drama of the incubator. So try to prevent preterm birth, these are the medications: progesterone, endomysis, intravenous magnesium, and calcium channel blockers. Regarding progesterone, which is recently a pioneer in the prevention of preterm birth, I'd like to highlight the most recent systematic review and meta-analysis speaking about the utilization of progesterone. And this is a forest plot. If you have an idea about the meta-analysis, you look to this figure. It's called the forest plot. Here, in patients with a history of preterm birth, it's functioning well. This is called the effect size of the estimate, net estimate, or the meta-estimate. It's functioning well in the patient with prior preterm birth. Again, patient with short cervix, as we detected by ultrasound, it functions well. But in patient with twins or twins and triplets, it didn't function. This data for the healthy ladies, and I'm sorry to say that there is no trials, any kind of trials, whether randomized or non-randomized, assessing the value of progesterone in the renal failure patients on dialysis and they are pregnant. There is no, but this is the only data from the healthy patients. So in my mind, I'm going to give those patients empirical progesterone and tabular evidence. Because that the, you know that the absence of evidence does not mean that there is no evidence. You should put in your mind that absence of evidence does not guarantee that there is no evidence. And someday we will have an evidence. The endomysicin. Endomysicin is very nice, an issue of the Willehen graft, because it's going to reduce the renal output from the baby. So the osmotic dialysis is going to improve. But it's very important, and we should highlight that you should use it for short periods and better before 34 weeks of gestation. Because if it's used for long duration, more than 3 days, and more than 24 weeks gestation, we will have premature closure of the ductus arteriosus of the baby. And this means pulmonary hypertension of the baby travels in the baby. So, if you'd like to use endomysicin, you should use these routes. Intravenous magnesium. And you know that magnesium is excreted by the kidney. And we should be cautious in those ladies to avoid the renal toxicity, and we have to maintain the level between 5 and 7 milligrams per deciliter. This is important. Calcium channel blockers is one of the recent issues again introduced in the era of topoletic drugs, such as the drugs which is going to prevent preterm birth. There's no fixed schedule, but this is the consensus goes around the initial loading dose is 10 to 40 milligrams, followed by 10 to 20 after 4 to 6 hours, and the dose titrated according to the contractions at the baby. This is important. I'd like to highlight a very, very important issue, that is the use of corticosteroids. And let me highlight the recommendation of the American College, recent recommendations, and the recommendation of the Royal College of London, again recent recommendations, that we have to give a single course of corticosteroids is recommended in women with a pregnancy duration at least 24 weeks or more to enhance the fetal lung maturity. We are going to expect preterm labor in those days, so we push steroids for a very easy and simple and single course, ketamicin of 12 milligrams, double doses, IM, one day apart, or dexamethasone, 6 milligrams, 4 doses, IM, every 12 hours. So this is an important issue. It's going to enhance the lung maturity. This is very crucial. When the baby is delivered prematurely, the neonatologist is going to ask you, did you give this baby receive the corticosteroids or not? This is a very crucial and differentiating part. Adequate fetal monitoring. And thanks really for ultrasound, we can estimate the fetal weight and assess the fetal growth, especially in the first, in the third trimester. And again, I refer you to the recommendation of the Royal College of London. And this is great recommendation. This is the, you know, Plan A is the best of the best, based on the randomized controlled trials. And we spoke about that the fetal abdominal circumference or estimated fetal weight below the 10th centile can be used to diagnose a small for gestational age fetus. SGA fetus, this is the IUGR baby. We call it SGA, the small for gestational age. Now the baby is below the 10th centile for the estimated gestational age. Okay? We have a category of tests, I'm not going to speak a lot about them. We call them fetal well-being tests. what the baby is inside the uterus, we can know the about the health status of the baby, like the fetal movement count, the non-stress test, the biophysical profile, and the Doppler velocimetry. And allow me to stress on the Doppler velocimetry because this is important. And again, I'm referring you again and again to the Royal College recommendation, one of the esteemed recommendations in the world. It's grade A. Speaking clearly, in a high-risk population like the patient on dialysis, the use of the umbilical artery Doppler to assess the circulation has been shown to reduce perinatal morbidity and mortality. Umbilical artery Doppler should be the primary surveillance tool. This is the issue today, rather than other tests and the SGA fetus. And if we find that the umbilical flow in these are normal, it's reasonable to repeat it after a couple of weeks. So we have to realize these recommendations properly and to make use of it. This is a very simple one of the umbilical artery Doppler, and these are the flow pulses. This is a systolic flow. There should be a diastolic flow here. And here it's absent. This picture, we call it absent in the diastolic flow, which is dangerous and warrants termination of pregnancy. If we go on like artery Doppler and we find absent in the diastolic flow, this is dangerous. We have to terminate the pregnancy. So you can imagine how important the Doppler ultrasound is in managing those ladies and high-risk ladies in general. The aim is to achieve delivery at full term, at least 38 weeks. Unless we have a complication and the lady develops severe preeclampsia, what are you going to do? You have to control and terminate. But if everything is going well, she's a lucky lady, try to continue, try to push the lady to 38 weeks this stage. The kidney disease is not an indication for cesarean section. It is not. And the indications are mainly obstetric indications. This is another important issue. And you folks, this is very important, should be monitored in high-risk pregnancy units and in high-risk neonatal units. Why? Because they are born with similar urea and creatinine levels to their mothers. This is important. And may suffer osmotic dialysis. This is very, very crucial issue. Allow me to conclude and to finish the presentation. We have to realize nowadays, and we are finishing 2013 and going to 2014, that the frequency of pregnancy in women on dialysis has increased from 1 to 7%. This is a dramatic increase, sevenfold increase. It's not that easy. The second issue, that the high maternal fetal mortality and morbidity rates are reported in those ladies as compared to normal population. What will be the solution in the multidisciplinary approach? The joint work between the nephrologist, obstetrician, and nutritionist. This is quite crucial. It's not a one-man show or a single-handed management. This is not accepted nowadays. And let me refer you to this quote finally of Henry Ford. You know this big man of the Ford Company, of the motor company in the world, who mentioned someday teamwork. Coming together is a beginning, like today. Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. Really, it's quite impressive words. These are the final thoughts I'd like to deliver. And finally, before I'm going to leave, I'd like to send my deepest gratitude and sincere thanks to this great eminent professor, really. That's my professor, the promoter of my thesis. He is Professor Herman Tourney, one of the eminent figures in the world of gynecology and obstetrics and reproductive endocrinology and fertility. He is the director and the scientific man of the Center of Reproduction and Fertility in the Free University of Brussels in Belgium, which I was honored really to have the PhD degree from him. I can't tell you how he was a supportive man, his morals, scientific activity, achievement, more than 280 international research publications. How can you imagine this man? And I'd like to wish him the best of success, really, and all the happy New Year's and happy returns for him. He encouraged me in the last 2 years, actually, during my journey to the PhD degree, which I have got just last November, the 28th of November. And this is Professor Chris Vanish Ravendish, another great man. He's the dean of the college today. You can't imagine when you sit with that man. How can you sit with a great dean, one of the great deans in the world? How these people think, really? I hope that someday we will have a move in our faculty and our universities and to achieve success. This is my hope, and I hope you the best of luck in your life and career. And again, I'd like to thank you for your life and commitment. Experience. It depends on the outcome. If this lady is generally well, and about the medications, what about the medications she receives? Yeah, I think these medications will not allow the lady to breastfeed. I think.
The dogmatic decision is to say to the mother, don't lactate.
Yeah.
Because even if you read in the background of the psychoscopic, it's written clearly, it's indicating the breastfeed. Yeah. But if you look at the data of the North American data, they can allow babies, allow ladies to lactate, because it's a very difficult social problem to deprive the mother of the lactation and outsource to breastfed the formulas and etc. But we usually, after this movement, we follow the dramatic way.
Yeah.
We don't like, especially the mother receive so our policy here, if the mother receives the driven immunosuppressive of drugs, we always say avoid lactation and we give her group 15 to suppress lactation and then and the baby will be fed on the pediatric side. But if we are dealing with the flu syndrome and the mother receives steroid only, we can allow it and breastfeed the baby so that she should receive less than 30 milligrams per centiliter, 70 milligrams. So actually, it's a very difficult question. If you are dogmatic, you would say no. But if you are to address the baby and the emotional upsets, because she needs to have the baby, if that's right, you can allow under certain conditions. Especially if she doesn't receive MMF and the
antibiotics. Okay. We have a lot of patients, three patients, women who got pregnant, and they have like basal, and they have a condition on the amount of drugs. So is there any other criteria to confirm that those patients have preeclampsia or eclampsia? Because even the...
I think your question, how to diagnose preeclampsia in our patients?
So, if the patient started by a baseline hypertension, proteinuria, this is not called a preeclampsia. It will be called superimposed preeclampsia. Because you know, preeclampsia is a disease of the second half of pregnancy. Okay? So, if you start, you have to stratify your patient. Now, this is a chronic hypertensive patient. Okay? So, if you categorize it as a chronic hypertensive patient, she is risky to have more and more trauma and superimposed preeclampsia to see me in the second half of pregnancy. So, again, very good. This is not preeclampsia. This is, we know that this is a pregnancy in a chronic hypertensive lady from the start. Deal with it like that. You have to manage the medications to start by the safest one so as to avoid, if she is in the ACE inhibitor, you have to convert it to alpha beside the woman, okay? So as to avoid the pregnancy. And you have to follow up the lady. And you have to do, again and again, assessment of the kidney function, assessment of the proteinuria, assessment of the blood pressure. If the basal increase, especially in the diastolic, is going to above 15, and the proteinuria is going to more and more heavy proteinuria. In the second half, this is sure, superimposed preeclampsia and eclampsia. This is a bad prognosis, actually. Okay?
external gases and more contributing by turn on our laboratory and bacteria to make sure that then we use the for going to be a
time. You speak about the reduction?
Yes,
so you speak about when you predict this lady also got supposed to be cancer or not. She is risky. You should realize that this is a risky lady for this issue. Okay? The point of prediction goes for the, not for the persons who have the history of this drama, but the other person. Let me say, the previous history of pre-cancer. Instead, she has a risk of recurrence.
So,
termination. So we look to the general condition of the lady and the general condition of the lady. If the lady achieved, has not severe brain cancer.
From the first perspective,
yeah.
Because Dr. Muhammad
will
see from our side, I hope to know from your
patient
about that.
Okay. My target is everything is controlled, the blood pressure is controlled. Okay? Proteinuria is mild. Growth of the baby is fine, you can continue. Till 38 weeks. Nowadays, of course, they mentioned that 34 weeks is considered dead, and they terminate at 34 weeks. But you can't say this is an issue, because instead, the terminator care is not so fine to leave the termination at 34 weeks.
My question, by other way.
If we have troubles like uncontrollable severe preeclampsia, you have to terminate. Control and terminate. No way. Whatever the gestational age. No way. Don't say that this is a 31 week gestation, the baby will be lost in the incubator, but the mother is going to be lost also.
My question is not restricted to me, because I know this.
Yeah.
If you have a patient who is sick with chronic kidney disease, acute kidney failure, acute kidney injury, or any kidney problems, do we, from your point of view, when you refer the patient about our desire to prevent pregnancy?
I would decide to prevent pregnancy if she developed complication. Let me say, what are your cancer? If she got severe polio damage, what will happen? She will have embarrassing symptoms. She will pass into preterm labor. This is one. The second issue, what about the growth of the baby? As I show you in the slides, if the baby may have got intracranial growth restriction, and you find by the Doppler that the increase is going to be affected, highest the ratio, then absent flow, you have to terminate. No way, otherwise you will lose the baby.
So this other restriction points to terminate. Otherwise, we discuss with the referrals.
Yes.
So I congratulate you for this view, and I stop the discussion here.
It will be a superimposed. This is not a preeclampsia, the usual one. The usual one is the blood pressure 140/90, proteinuria plus one. Okay?
Yeah.
This is the preeclampsia.
Oh, blood pressure,
increase
of blood pressure,
the patient, good. This patient, if you have a hypertensive patient, whether with or without proteinuria, we call it a chronic hypertensive lady from the start. That's right. This patient already is a high-risk patient to have superimposed preeclampsia. I'm not going to terminate. She is controlled and she is fine. Okay? If she is controlled, why you terminate pregnancy and the baby is growing fine? Why this is a point? If you give her the whole medication, the blood pressure is going to be high and high and high. The symptoms, the headache, high and high and high. What will happen? Okay? You have troubles in the liver functions. You might have Hemp syndrome. You have to terminate. So, you should think of the terminal and the baby.
Your answer is perfect.
Thank you.
This is perfect for me and for all our discussion.
Okay.
We will continue to Dr. Muhammad to promote the network. It's going to happen.